Erev Tov, good evening. We will continue on this topic of Ishmael, the third in this series, discussing what could possibly be the future soon in our generation, for the people of Israel, of course. Which means talking about the Mashiach. So far we have discussed last week the difference between our generation and the past generations. Referring, of course, since we understand that we are approaching that time which has been the prophecies of all the Bible, the biblical prophecies, as well as the Talmudical and Midrashic and Zoharic prophecies and predictions. It seems to be, according to many signs, that this is the time, this is the generation, since there was never a generation before that can be like ours. There was never a generation like ours. And in accordance with what we have been studying in the Talmud as well as in the Zohar, it appears to be that this generation has brought about all those signs that were predicted long time ago, 2,000 years from the time of the Talmud, and even before in biblical time. And we did ask a question last week. Why is it that we are sure? I mean, what makes us think that this generation could be the eventual generation that will bring the Messiah and the final redemption of the Jewish people? What makes us believe that it could be this generation when we know that this generation is at least intellectually and spiritually lower than all the generations before? That is, of course, in accordance with the philosophy of our sages, because if you ask people, common people, they will tell you that this generation is extraordinary because of its scientific inventions and progress. It is true. There was no generation before that has progressed by leaps and bounds like this generation, which in a matter of 100 years has invented and discovered so many secrets of the universe more than 5,000 years before have ever discovered. But at the same time, talking from the point of view of character and talking from the point of view of the spiritual situation of the human being, what makes him a good man, a good person, and at the same time also vis-a-vis the scholarship in Torah, since the Torah is the source of all these predictions, we have to refer to it with the utmost seriousness and gravity of the spirit. There's no question about it. So when we talk about giants of Torah, each generation has its giants. No question about it. 1,000 years ago, the giant of the Torah was the Rambam, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimonides, Rashi, and the great sages of the last 1,000 years. Those were the giant ones. If we come to compare them to our generation, we will find that our giants, and we do have some, but they will be puny, very, very small compared to the giants of the past. And even if you go back 1,000 years ago, in the time of Rashi and Rambam, which is the glory of the Jewish people, no question about it. Every Jew who learns Torah must learn Rambam and must learn Rashi and all the others. He cannot obtain any level of scholarship without going through the giants of the last 1,000 years. And before the Gaonic era, Rabbi Saadia Gaon, Rav Sherira Gaon, Rav Hai Gaon, and other Gaonim. Today, Gaon means genius. But in those times, Gaon means the one who practically masters all the scope of the Torah, the oral Torah as well as the written Torah. And then the Gaonim, the time of the Gaonim, lasted for a few hundreds of years, but it existed 1,200, 1,300 years ago, and so forth. You understand? But before that, even though the Gaonim, the time of Rabbi Saadia Gaon, is much greater than the time of the Rambam, who comes after, but still those who preceded, who came before the time of the Gaonim, they are not to be compared with the Gaonim. For example, the sages of the Gemara, of the Talmud, like Rav, Rabbi Chiya, Rav Huna, those are the luminaries of the last, I mean not the last, but rather of 1800 years ago. And you cannot compare no one of us, no one in our generation, no one in the last generation, no one in the last 1,000 years, and no one in the last 1,500 years, to the generation of the sages of the Gemara, like Rabbi Yochanan and Resh Lakish, and Rav, and Rav Huna, and Rav Shmuel, those that we study every day in the Talmud. But even those great luminaries, if you compare them with the sages that came before, the sages of the Mishnah, like Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Tarfon, Rabban Gamliel, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, Rabbi Yehoshua ben Hanania, and so many more who lived 2,000 years ago in the time of the Mishnah and ending with the era of Rabbeinu HaKadosh known as Rabbi. That's the famed Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi. Those cannot be compared to the generations that came after them. And that's the reason why in the Talmud you don't find any argument between the sages who lived 1,800 years ago and the sages who lived 2,000 years ago. You will never find an argument or a difference of opinion between, for example, between Rav Huna, who lived 1,800 years ago in Babel, in Babylon, with Rabbi Akiva. Impossible. Because Rabbi Akiva is known as a Tanna, a sage of the Mishnah. And the sage of the Mishnah does not compare with the sage of the Gemara. The sage of the Gemara is much lower. And obviously, even those sages of 2,000 years ago, the sages of the Mishnah, are smaller than the sages who came before, such in the time of Hillel and Shammai, or Shimon HaTzadik. And finally, up to the sages of the great assembly, which we discussed in the past, the 120 rabbis who lived 2,600 years ago, immediately after the destruction of the first temple, as soon as the Jews, most of the Jews went to Babylon, were taken to Babylon. At that time, the great assembly was organized, and because of them, we have survived as Jews. Ezra HaSofer. We could find him in the Bible. One of the small books of the Bible is known as Ezra. And Ezra was the spiritual leader of the great assembly of those 120 rabbis, among whom we find also Mordechai and Esther. All these are already biblical figures. And even those cannot compare with the generations before, such as the generation of King David and King Solomon, who were endowed with much greater gift of the Ruach HaKodesh as well as the great depth of the Torah, knowing they were closer to Moshe Rabbeinu, therefore they were able to have access to many more of the mysteries and secrets of the Torah, much more than those who came after them. And finally, the generation that came before them, that is the generation of the wilderness with Moshe and Yehoshua, this is known as the biggest of all the generations. And therefore our sages said an enigmatic statement. In Rishonim, we already cited it last week, and many times before probably. Im Rishonim, ki bnei Adam, anachnu kachamorim. Ve'im Rishonim, ki malachim, anachnu ki bnei Adam. If we consider the old generations, the great luminaries of the ancient generations, if we consider them like angels, then we can consider our generation as human beings. But if we consider them as just plain human beings, then we are considered like plain donkeys. And not even the donkey of Pinchas ben Yair. It is true, if you are versed in the Talmud, in the sea, in the ocean of Torah, when you delve into it in depth, then you realize, how can we compare ourselves to those sages that we study every day and discovering the scope of their inimaginable understanding? Compared to us, we feel like little birds. When we study, even this morning, I was teaching a certain passage of the Talmud in Masechet Chagiga, having to do with the transmission of infections, but talking about spiritual infections such as Tum'ah and Tahara, purity and impurity. The way it was analyzed by the sages with such depth, it was a very, very hard thing to transmit, to explain to the students. I mean, I'll give you an example. As a doctor, probably you will make up something of it that has to do also with the way we interpret the progress of infections and so forth. For example, there is a discussion in the Talmud regarding the transmission of purity, of impurity. Let's say you touch something that is impure, like a rat. If you touch it with one hand, the right hand, so the question is, does the right hand transmit it automatically to the left hand? And what about if the left hand is touching something, will this thing that you are, I mean, something that is edible, something that is about to be eaten, can it already infected? And automatically even that which you were touching with the left hand, which was not exposed to the impurity, only the right hand was exposed. But does it have the possibility to go and transfer it to the other? There is a big discussion on in the Talmud. And when you come to think about it with modern eyes, you will find out that that we are discussing something that is extraordinarily scientific. That if the doctors of today, if the scientists of today were able to translate according to their own language, they would probably discover tremendous discoveries. Like I think I did mention once that there is a certain text in the Talmud in Masechet Yoma. If I am not wrong, I think it's page 33, without guaranteeing that. But it says there a statement that was verified by the scientists and professors of the University of Jerusalem as exactly the source of a tremendous discovery. A discovery that was made 165 years ago by the greatest scientist on earth in France. That discovery, which was discovered 165 years ago, was in fact discovered by our sages 2000 years ago, only presented in different language. In a language that is more or less, for example, 200 years ago in Europe, they suffered a lot from the rabbis, sick dogs, for example. Rabbis. It cost millions of lives. And finally, they developed by Pasteur, Louis Pasteur, he developed the serum that can be injected into the guy who was infected by the dog, by the sick dog, and thus survive. By giving him the serum which was taken from the dog itself that has infected him. And that was a big discovery that gave the Nobel Prize to Louis Pasteur and made him become one of the greatest scientists of all times. His theory has been already discovered by our sages 2,000 years ago, where it says specifically, "Kol mi shenoshech oto kelev shote, ya'achilehu mechatzar kavdo shelo." Our sages said, in a very simple way, anyone who has been bitten by a sick dog, he should take the dog and take the basis of its liver. Probably, if they did it, they had to do it in a very pure way, which means that they had to first distill or made the liver possible, and they would extract from it the serum or the vaccine with which to deal with this infection, which is exactly the theory of Louis Pasteur. And yet Louis Pasteur got all the honors. And what I told you now, I even heard it myself in the University of Jerusalem long time ago by Professor Orbach, in which he gave us even more examples of the tremendous superiority of the sages of then compared to even the science of today. And I'm not talking about science. No question about it that the science of today is in great and full advance than any other generation. But at the same time, we find things that were written long time ago, thousands of years ago. See what you did, Margareta? Sorry. You understand? What was I saying, doctor? Huh?
Sorry, Margareta.
Many of the great discoveries, I mean, listen, a great discovery today would mean a simple prediction then. I don't know if anybody would agree with me in this. And I don't care if nobody will agree with me. But the point is, has been made already, that some of the great inventions and discoveries by the science have been already told us in the books of Kabbalah, no end. And in the Talmud, as well as in the Midrash, and especially in the Zohar, only presented as a prediction, not as the discovery of science, with a few exceptions here and there. When our sages said that we cannot compare ourselves to those generations before, there is definitely something to think about. Because people have the tendency to think today that there is no other generation that is superior to ours. By the Jewish philosophy, the religious Jewish philosopher regards the ancient time as much more superior than our time. Whereas in the eyes of the Goyim, for example, or the modern world, so to speak, or the secular world, it is exactly the opposite. That all the ancient generations were very low, and therefore nothing to compare with us, we are the superior. But our sages said, anybody who thinks this way, it's exactly like taking a dwarf, Nannas, kan nannas al gabeha anak. You take a dwarf, you want him to be taller than the giant, put him on the shoulder of the giant. And then you will think that this guy, who is in fact only half a meter tall, is taller than the giant, who is 3 meters tall. Why? Because he is on the shoulder. So all the big things today, they appear to be very superior to the past, only because the past is the giant, and we stand on its shoulder. Never mind. That was only to explain the point as an introduction to that which we made already last week, that our generation is supposedly the last one because it's the smallest and the lowest one. The lowest intellectually, Don't be afraid to think about it, even though today science, of course, is, and the Enlightenment is nothing to compare with the previous generation. Can anybody compare any rabbi today to Ramban? I'm not saying Rambam. Rambam is Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, the one who was the doctor. At the same time, he was the greatest halachic posek that of all times. And what he wrote makes us incapable of even thinking how did he do it when he was so busy being a doctor. The chief doctor of the Sultan, Salah ed-Din. I'm not talking about Maimonides. Let's go just about 150 years later. That's the time of the Ramban, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman. Can we compare anyone today to the extraordinary mind of the Ramban? We study Ramban today, we find it very difficult even to understand. When we understand, then we discover, oh my God, what a mind. But let's not even go to those luminaries of the last 800 years ago. We can just go back 200 years ago. Or even 100 years ago, the time of the Ben Ish-Chai. Can anybody today compare himself to the Ben Ish-Chai? A giant man who lived there. A rabbi who lived in Iraq, in Baghdad. Do you know the great mysteries that he discusses in his book, Ben Ish-Chai? At every opening of every week's weekly parasha, when he tells us Kabbalistical concepts that are defying the normal brains of today. Let alone the Vilna Gaon who lived 250 years ago. Let alone other, unbelievable. What about Maran, the Shulchan Aruch, who lived 450 years ago? Can we compare? All the great geniuses of today, all they write is only based on what was written before. Remove, take away from them Rambam, take away from them Rashi, take away from them the Geonim, take away from them Baalei HaTosfot, take away from them the Rishonim. They find nothing to write. You cannot write. The greatest mind today, if it writes, it will write only based on the tremendous theories and philosophies that were written in the past. And here we go, here we come now to this generation. As glorious as it is. Well, we still say that this generation will be the generation that will bring the Mashiach, that will bring Ben Ish-Chai, the Messiah who is going to bring the light into the world and bring redemption to the Jewish people. And finally, the Jewish people will not have to say yes to America and to stop the buildings in Jerusalem. I think America is very naive. There are things that they demand from Israel and they don't even realize that. No matter how much Israel can go around and around, it cannot say yes. It just, there are things that you cannot ask from us. But America still doesn't realize that. I think it's a matter of naivete. But if it's not naivete, then it is a very big evil. Stop them building buildings in Gilo, Shchuna of Yerushalayim. How can we say that? So today Israel has decided to go ahead with another 900 buildings, 900 units, regardless of what America and the rest of the world are saying. Now, of course, this has already started. It has started already. Arguments and complaints. Britain is angry. America is angry. They don't like it. What are you talking about? Say thank you that they told you we will try for some other areas. Well, but this generation is bringing that one. Is bringing him, Mashiach ben David. But we will have to go first. After we have been through so much throughout all the generations, and after the Holocaust, but we have we have arrived now to the conclusion of the final exile of the Jewish people, the exile of Ishmael, as we have discussed in the past, in the last week. Why do I say after the Holocaust? Because the exile of Ishmael has started already with the appearance of Muhammad 1500 years ago. But it was not in great progress until the culmination of all those years, which is today. Today, why is it important? Because this, for the first time, we see the prediction, the prophecy of the exiles coming back to Eretz Israel. Jews dispersed all over the world are now coming back to the land of Israel. For 2,000 years, this never happened. It did not happen for 2,000 years. So there is ground upon which we can build this assumption, if not assumption, then maybe this theory, that this is it. Because one of the biggest prophecies is about kibbutz galuyot, the ingathering of all the exiles. And that's happening in tremendous steps. There's no question about it. Immediately after the Holocaust began the immigration of Jews to Israel. And such a thing never happened before. For the last 2,000 years, since the destruction of the Second Temple, based on the biblical prophecies and the predictions as brought in the Talmud and the Midrash and the Zohar, it looks like this is it. The only problem is that with it, you have to take also other predictions, such as the misery of this time and the troubles. But all the troubles we were given the promise that with after at the end of the troubles we will see the great light. The great light in the form of a great leader will come from the line of David, and he will be another Moshe Rabbeinu. And not only the Israel will be redeemed, but somehow the whole world also will be redeemed, or whatever will be left from the world. Since we cannot pretend, what is it that they want from us in this generation? We already said that we are the smallest. How much can you ask a small little guy? If we are so little, then can you ask me to be Moshe Rabbeinu? Can you ask me to be Rabbi Akiva? We already explained that those were the giants of all the years. So nobody can pretend to ask me to be like Rabbi Akiva. Not even to be like my grandfather. I cannot, because we believe, Judaism believe, that the past generations are greater than our generation. So today, if you want to look for anybody smaller than you, look in your own generation. Because even simple fathers of the last generation are better than us. At least character-wise. And I think you don't need to pressure your brain to agree with that. Because today, the lack of morality and the extreme exaggerations in immoral and corrupt things make it definitely clear that we are in that generation when our character has been extremely affected. We are not anymore as good as we were before. But that's the situation. Take it or leave it. So since we are so small, so now the question is, how much do you ask from us? We cannot pretend to be like the past generations in matters of perfection. Can you ask me to be perfect? I can be perfect in accordance with our level. But I cannot be perfect in accordance with the level of 100 years ago. And much more, like the perfection of Abraham Avinu, or Sarah, or Rachel, or Rivka, or Yaakov and Yitzchak. Impossible. So what kind of perfection do you ask from me? Can you ask me the same purity? Impossible. I just told you before, a small text from the Talmud, and the Talmud, 50% of the Talmud consists of those topics, the topics of purity and impurity that we have nothing to do with them today. And if you know how difficult they are to analyze and to study, then you will understand what I am trying here to say. So can anybody ask me to conduct myself with the same purity as they conducted themselves last generation? No. What about the holiness? What about abstinence and self-control? Can we? So what is exactly the expectation that is from us? Cannot be as demanding as the previous generations. Huh? Today the forces of evil, not only the fact that we are lower in our capability and capacity to understand things that were understood in the far past, but the forces of evil and Satan are supreme today. Because it has the material, it has the vessels with which he performs, Satan. I mean, 100 years ago, what did they have compared to what we have today? Today you have television, you have computers, you can go anywhere you want, in the internet, anywhere. You want good, you'll find good. You want bad, you'll find bad. Everything is at your disposal. Satan has come to the houses of everyone. I hear stories from families who come to me. Even tonight, a lady, a very young lady, she was crying with heavy tears just before I came tonight. A young lady with a baby of 6 months old, crying to me like a baby. And telling me that her husband, who apparently became religious, he came from Yemen and he became religious. And she's telling me that he's no more what he used to be. That she cannot, I don't want here to mention things that are to expose the matter too much. But just to tell you the gravity of the situation. Good people, how today are easily destroyed spiritually. Corruption is rampant. Immorality is unbelievable. I mean, the degree of immorality is just beyond description. So the forces of evil and Satan today are so supreme that compared to the ancient generations, we are definitely at extreme low. That's what our sages say in the Gemara. Hadorot holchim umitma'atim. From the beginning of time, the generations were made to go lower and lower and lower. Thus, our power to fight against sin, our power to fight against sin has diminished. In the old time, they had self-control. I could tell you stories and stories and stories. Today, we are almost helpless. Are we in control? That's a big question. At least our power to control ourselves has diminished no end. At the same time, the power of sin has multiplied. Temptations, desires, everything has increased. They have increased in accordance with the great numbers of tempting forces. So many things that tempt us, these generations, unbelievable. Wherever you go, there is something that tempts you. 100 years ago, they didn't even know that such a thing could ever exist in the world. Today, you don't even have to turn your head to be tempted. So therefore, the question is, what can be expected from our generations? We already said total purity is impossible. If you ask somebody total purity, he will laugh at you. What about cleanness from sin? Impossible. Can you run away from sin today? Sin, today you don't have to run after the sin. The sin runs after you. You don't have to close the door before him. He's already there at home. So the question remains, what is it that is expected from us today? Well, here it is. Based on the teachings of our sages, who knew what's going to be this generation. In this generation, what is expected for us is only to demonstrate a will to fight. Not to fight and win, just to show that you want to fight. You fall, you try again. You resist, but you couldn't resist finally, and you fail. Start all over again. That's what is expected from us this generation. You have to keep trying no matter how many times you fail. 2,000 years ago, one statement was made in the Mishnah, in Masechet Yoma, Ha'omer echta ve'ashuv, echta ve'ashuv, en maspikim la'asot biyado tshuva. Anybody who says, I will sin, but I will repent, I will sin, I will repent, they don't give him the possibility to do teshuva. Today we cannot say that no more. Maximum we'll tell the people, you have to sin. But try again, once more, try again. Which means don't give up, because if you give up, what's left? Like somebody he cannot come to the synagogue. He comes, okay, one day he finally comes, fine. Next day, again he's absent. So you keep telling him, what's going on? He said, I can't! Oh yeah, you can't. What do you mean you can't? If you have a business, if somebody calls you, I have a $5,000 business, you have to come now, 3 o'clock in the morning. He would get up like a lion. So how come? I can't! I just can't, he said. Oi, he says, sleep for me so dear. He says, I can't, I just can't. Don't ask me, Rabbi, please. All it takes is a girlfriend to call him up from the airport. He'll be there first. That's the old story. People think they cannot. You know, according to the Torah, one should not say I cannot in anything. The truth is that one can everything. The problem is that people convince themselves that they cannot. But Hashem exposes them by giving them situations in which they discover that they do have the possibility. I mean, he said you can, like the Gemara tells us, the Talmud tells us, that if someone is very rich, so when he goes to heaven, after 120, they'll tell him, why didn't you do this, why didn't you do that, why didn't you do? So he says, what can I do? You're to blame. You made me rich. Being rich, I had no time. They said to him, were you richer than Rabbeinu HaKadosh? Were you richer than Rabbi Elazar ben Charsom? Some very, very, very rich rabbis who lived in the past. And yet, they did everything properly and they learned Torah every day. But at the same time, they were extremely rich. Rabbi Tarfon had so many lands and fields, he didn't know what he had. Even the workers in the fields didn't know their own boss. One day when Rabbi Tarfon came to inspect his possessions, his properties, so one of the goyim was in charge of keeping the order there, he thought that this is a thief. And he fell on Rabbi Tarfon, and he put him in a bag, and Rabbi Tarfon didn't want to scream to say to him, I am Rabbi Tarfon, because the name Rabbi Tarfon was so great in the world that he would use the crown of Torah. So he says, I don't want to use the crown of Torah. This is something we cannot understand. Today, definitely not. Today they will laugh. They will say, come on, Rabbi Tarfon, just say who you are and shut up, and that's it. He will let you go. At the end, finally, when he opened the bag and he saw, he said, what are you? I'm Tarfon, I'm the owner. And then he says, I'm sorry. So they will tell you in heaven, were you richer than Rabbi Tarfon? He couldn't count his own money, and yet he was in the yeshiva learning Torah, and he found the time for everything. All right, let's say you were not very rich, but you were a handsome boy, a great boy. In heaven, after 120, why were you such a bad boy? What can I do, he would say. You made me, look at me, Elvis Presley, I am very handsome. So what do you want me to do? My Satan was very big because you made me very handsome. So they will say to him, oh yeah, were you more handsome than Yosef at Tzaddik? You know Joseph? Joseph was the most handsome man on earth. And yet, he kept his education that he got from his father Yaakov properly. Even in the land of Egypt, he did not sway from it. Okay, let's say somebody is very poor. After 120, he goes to heaven. Why didn't you what you were expected to do? He said, what can I do? You made me so poor, I had to work hard for Parnassa. Were you poorer than Hillel? They will tell him. You know that Hillel? Hillel, the famed leader of Israel, who lived 2,300 years ago, he was so poor that he had to go and, in order to pay the doorman to go to Beit HaMidrash to learn, he had to give him 50% of his salary, which he got by cutting the wood in the forest. You know the story of Hillel. You know, he came on the roof. One day he didn't have enough money to go to the Beit Midrash. So he went up the roof. The snow came on him, covered him. They thought. And then it was Shabbat. And when they cleared the area, they found him almost dead. That's when they decided to let everyone come free. So can you be poorer than Hillel? And so forth and so forth. So nobody can say any excuse, because already God has taken care of all the excuses. Whatever you think that you cannot, God is going to prove to you that you definitely could if you wanted. So what makes us blind is Satan and the things that make this world so pleasurable. At the same time, he steals away all the time that you could use for good things and things that are everlasting. Because the truth is that with all the luxuries that we have today, I mean, if you come to check life the way it is, you know that life does not last forever. And yet, what comes after, if you believe, then you know that will never come to an end. So therefore, one has to ask his question, what is more of interest to me? And that does not mean that if you choose the interest of eternality versus the interest of this very short time in this life, that does not mean that you have to give up the good things of this life. That's not true. But that's also one of the things that Satan makes you think, that if you give up on certain things, that means you don't live the proper life. That is not true. Take, for example, the people who keep Shabbat. After a few years that they kept Shabbat, give them any amount you want, they will not give up on keeping Shabbat. Keeping Shabbat is one of the greatest pleasures that we have in life. Imagine, you go to work every day, 6 days a week. I spoke about this last week, because the Talmud says that Shabbat is considered to be a gift. Like it says in the Talmud, when God wanted to give the Jewish people Shabbat, He said to Moshe, I have a gift. Matana achat yeshli bevet genazai veshabbat shma. He said to Moshe, I have in my treasury a beautiful gift. It's called Shabbat. I would like to give it to my people. Tell them, lech vehodi'am. Go and tell them. So I asked the question. I said, why is it called matana? Why is it called a gift? What is the gift? I mean, I understand. Shabbat is a situation. It's a day. It comes, and you don't have to go to work. Fine, it's great. But where is the gift? Usually the gift is something that you feel you got. So I said, besides all the gifts and the greatness of Shabbat, here is what it gives us. If there was no Shabbat, you know what would happen? People would fall into habit of everything, and they would lose the sense of humanity. We need to be awakened every now and then. Because if you count on yourself, you are going to go from day to day, the same thing. One day you will discover that you are not anymore a human being. You are practically an instinctive little animal. But Hashem gave us a tremendous gift. He says, I know that problem. I know I gave you permission to work 6 days a week. But if I let you work day after day, you are going to lose the sense of your own humanity. You are going to be just instinctive, just a product of habit. What do I do in order to awaken you and get you out of the habit enough to get you ready for another week? Shabbat. Day after day, from Monday to Friday, you work. You lose your senses. You become material. You become physical. And then comes Shabbat. It changes you on the spot. Immediately after you took your shower and you prepare yourself for Shabbat, you discover that now you are a different person. You don't take the phone. You don't open the television. You go to synagogue. Now you think more about spiritual things. Ah, that's an awakening. You became aware suddenly of the spiritual obligations. That's a wonderful gift. Imagine, if you don't believe me, watch people who have no Shabbat. These people are product of instinct and habit. They will not have the power to get out of habit. I'll give you a little mashal. You know, many Jews, unfortunately, are not religious. But when comes Yom Kippur, they do fast. Ah, they come to the synagogue and they fast. Their face is like a mourner, like Avel. Now, you know what I discover? Usually, people who are religious are used to fast. We fast 6 times a year. We fast in Ta'anit Esther. We fast in Shiva Asar B'Tammuz. We fast in Tisha B'Av. We fast in... no, what else? Tell me, Reuven. I said Esther already. Before Rosh Hashanah, Tzom Gedalia, very good. I mean, after Rosh Hashanah, the day after Rosh Hashanah. And, you know, we have 4 plus Tisha B'Av, that's 5, and plus Yom Kippur, that's 6. So 6 times, when Yom Kippur comes, it's not the end of everything. You feel that usually that are people that are religious are not dying on the day of Yom Kippur. But watch those people who never come to synagogue. On Yom Kippur, they are so sick. I tell you the truth, I look at them, I say, it's unbelievable. Go like, yes, amen. And then he sleeps. I said, Ribbona shel olam. Why is that? He's not used to it. What can he do? Religious Jews have tremendous superiorities in certain things than non-religious people. And it's true, by the way, in everything. So if you consider the gift of Shabbat, just what I just told you, as a day in which we wake up, then now you discover, whether you like it or not, even a Jew who is not so much into Judaism is enough Shomer Shabbat. Okay. He discovers that Shabbat now he becomes more, a little bit more spiritual. Some of the physicalities, some of the materialism has gone away from him. Now he thinks about to do Kiddush, to do Birkat HaMazon, to sing on Shabbat, to go to prayer. It's a different day. And now Sunday again, he goes, now at least he goes afresh. Until the next Shabbat, when he will wake up again. But if we didn't have that alarm clock that we call Shabbat, boy oh boy, what would we do? So now you tell me why Hashem called it Matana, a gift, here is a gift. He wanted to preserve our eternality. You have to understand that if we don't wake up to our spirituality and we stay buried in our material and physicality, we cannot pretend to wake up one day in the world to come. Our neshama becomes extinct. There's only one thing that brings it, gives it life again. That spark that we call Shabbat, or when you learn Torah. Of course, if you learn Torah every day, you are in that stage of a way of awareness all the time, all the time. Like in the very beginning of the book of Mesilat Yesharim, The Path of the Just, written by Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lotzato, one of the greatest men that ever came to the Jewish people. He lived approximately 450 years ago. He gave us Mesilat Yesharim, and he begins the Mesilat Yesharim with these words, Torah mevi'a lidei zehirut. He doesn't tell you Torah gives you brains or gives you science. He gives you awareness. And then from awareness he goes to Zrizut, then it gives you the action. You become more invigorated. And then the result gets you into higher level and higher level and higher level till you reach the realm of Ruach HaKodesh. But it starts with Zehirut. Zehirut means clairvoyance, clarity, awareness. If a person does not do certain things to his life to wake him up, people will become instinctive like any animal. That's all. And Hashem, when He gave us Shabbat, He gave it only to the Jewish people. Of course, later they took Sunday, and then the Kaaba, they took also Friday. You know, what else they didn't want to steal from us? But our sages said in the Talmud, Goy she Shabbat chayav mita. It is a very mysterious statement, where it says, a Goy who took up Shabbat, I mean to keep it like we do, is under the penalty of death. That's, by the way, figurative. That's not operative. Why? I mean, if he wants to keep Shabbat, let him keep the Shabbat. As a Goy, not as a Ger. If he converts to Judaism, it's something else. No, this is a gift that is exclusive to the Jewish people. So now a Goy, like it happened in my life. I remember a few years ago, when I was building the Sukkah, I had a Goy that was working in my house, doing some renovations. And the guy was contemplating everything that we do at home. He even came on Shabbat. I said, what do you want? I said to him, what do you want from us? Shabbat, of course, we don't use Shabbat. A Goy is not allowed to work for you on Shabbat. You know that. That's a halakha in Shulchan Aruch. In chapter 244, chapter 245, and chapter 246 are dealing only with the laws. What kind of work can you give the Goy to do for you? And in general, you cannot give him any job that he can do for you. Even if he does it himself, I mean, you still, it's forbidden since he does it for you. So when he came, I said to him, Walter, what's the matter? Why did you come? On Shabbat, you don't work. Because he had a big word. It took him more than 2 months in my house. He said, Rabbi, please. All I came is for one reason. I just came to see how you eat on Shabbat. I just want to see how you eat. How you eat, okay? And then again, it was Sukkot. And he came again just to see us how we sit in Sukkot. Later on, we discovered that this boy became a priest. And he wanted to learn. He was fascinated by our Shabbat. And I saw on his face jealousy. He understood, as a religious Goy, he understood some of the truth. And he knew that the truth belongs to us, not to him. Do you know, if I tell you a little secret, that's the reason why they hate us in the world? Because we are the truth. They know they don't belong to it. The Talmud says, Goy sheshavat chayav mita. If a Goy starts doing, let's say he doesn't give up his Goyishness, but he wants to do Shabbat, he can have death. I mean, figuratively talking. That's the penalty. Why? Because this is a gift that is exclusive to the people of Israel. The question is that we should ask is why? What's the big deal? Let him do Shabbat. Hashem says, no. It's impossible. Since a Goy doesn't have the possibility, because without Torah, you cannot have Shabbat. And without Shabbat, you cannot have that awareness that I told you. And since you don't have that awareness, you cannot pretend to have the world to come. The only way for the Goy, let me tell you a little, even though it sounds presumptuous, but just hear it. The Goy, there's only one way for him to earn the world to come, the life, afterlife. It's only if he saved the Jewish life, and if he never had feelings of resentment and anti-Semitism against us. Then he could be known, and if he saved Jews, he is known as Chassidei Umot HaOlam, righteous among the non-Jews, they give them something in the afterlife. But afterlife, you might say, I'm just saying those things, and who knows who's listening to us. I just want you to know that it's impossible, almost impossible, to have the afterlife if you are not Jewish. And if you don't keep Shabbat, and you don't keep the Torah. By the way, I'm telling you those things not out of my religiousness. I'm not that, very much. But because I know the truth. And I'm sharing with you the truth. And I want you to believe me that this is the truth. Why? Because I have been analyzing it with my friends and my teachers and all my life. I have been analyzing this truth to the core of my heart. And there is no other truth but this. It is just impossible to gain eternal life without having the ingredients for it. And the ingredients is the Torah, and the mitzvot that we have, and Shabbat. Because Shabbat is what makes us accessible to this. Comes Shabbat, every even Jew that is not usually religious, he knows that there is a difference. I mean, you could see it in the air. Friday evening, you see in the air, you don't see that it is Shabbat. Go outside, it is Shabbat. It's like Shabbat is screaming, I am Shabbat. Let alone because we dress better and everything, we eat better and we sing. But even the air, of course, I guess it has to do with the more level you are into Shabbat, the more you know about Shabbat, the more you will feel. But there is no question about it that the air can be eaten with your own teeth, with your own mouth on Shabbat. The air. I remember the Spanish and Portuguese synagogue. I recorded for them a recording, long time, talking about 20 years ago. I sang for them, they wanted me to give them a series of songs with explanations in between. I have the tape. They produced thousands from it. It's called the Lecha Dodi tape. I'm singing there, I'm speaking with my old English. Well, no, today's a little better. But I remember I said those words. If you want Margareta or anyone, I'll bring you the tapes. I'll bring it to you. And it says there, that I am describing Jews going to the synagogue in the old ghettos, in Morocco or anywhere. That after they took their bath, each one I used to see them with my eyes of a young lad, and see them all red with the soap and taking their bath. And the smell of soap was all over the air going to the synagogues. And I said, my God, here is the face of Shabbat. Of course, there's not much described there. But at the same time, you felt that Shabbat, for every Jew, even just by habit, the Jew suddenly dropped everything, all the business, and now he wants, this one goes to mikveh, this one goes to his bathhouse, this one goes to take a shower, whatever it is, and then he goes to synagogue. It's not like today when so many Jews don't realize, don't experience that. And then they come back surrounded with two angels. You know that, doctor? That when we come back from the synagogue on Friday night, you have two angels that come with you? And that's why when you go home, you say, Shalom, Shalom Aleichem. No, that's not how you say it. No? You say, Sephardic way. Of course. But the point is that Shabbat is an awakener. It's an alarm clock. Not to fall into physicality, so Hashem provided for us the possibility to become a little bit spiritual, so that we keep in touch with the future of spirituality. In the future, there is only spirituality. The afterlife is the neshama. You understand that? And that the goyim cannot have. Cannot have. I told you the only way for a goy to have something of that. But they believe, of course, not only they know they are going to have virgins. What else they are going to have? Nice. All they have to do is to kill a few children with a suicide bombing. So anyway, my friends, what is expected from us today is only to demonstrate the will to fight. To expect perfection, we already said it's impossible. Of course, if you can, go ahead, ahlan wa sahlan. But at least Jews must try to do the best they can. Why? Because we have to prove to God that the reason we fail is not because we are rebellious. It's not that we don't believe in you, God. We believe in you, only we are weak. If we can do that, we remain in touch. We remain in touch. We are proving to God that in our sin there is no rebellion, only weakness on our part, due to the intense sources that lead to sin. That's why our sages said in the book of Tana de Eliyahu, in chapter 25, Eliyahu Rabba, Le'olam chayav adam lomar, matay yagi'u ma'asai, le'ma'ase avotai. One should live only, always, with the aspiration, saying, when will I reach the deeds of my forefathers? That's all that is being expected from us. To desire to be better. At the same time, if we fail, and there is not one day that we don't fail, but at least we have to try again. We have to try, to keep on trying, not to give up and say, I can't, like I said before. We know that to reach the level of our forefathers is presumptuous, not even rational. But truly, because truly we can't. But externally we can at least emulate them according to our level. Now, you might say, well, come on, Rabbi, that low, we are that low. This low evaluation about our capabilities pertains only to this generation. And how do we know that? When we check this generation in accordance with all the good things that we have, with all the scientific things and inventions and discoveries that we have. And it is the generation before the Mashiach. I'm going to explain that if you give me a few minutes. Actually, during this generation, our forces and strength will multiply to the level of our forefathers when the Mashiach comes. How is it possible? I mean, we have reached the lowest level, and yet I am saying that this is the generation in which we are going to jump again to the highest level when the Mashiach comes. So what's going on? Let me go take you to the time of Egypt. Remember when the Jewish people were in Mitzrayim? Our sages said that they were in such a deplorable situation that they reached a Kabbalistical statement, Memtet Sha'are Tum'ah. Our forefathers in Egypt, before they received the Torah, that's over 3,500 years ago, when they were slaves in Egypt, they have reached in Egypt, which was the core of immorality in the world. Being in Egypt, our forefathers, the people, have reached the lowest level of impurity. It's called the 49th degree of impurity, of Tum'ah. Memtet, Sha'are Tum'ah. That's a Kabbalistical concept. You have to know one thing. I'm going to share with you this, whatever. We're sharing with the world. So you have to know that even impurity, which means evil, which means bad, has levels. The highest level is 50. There are 50 levels of impurity. When you reach 49, you are in really bad shape, right? 49 is the worst. Our sages said that that's the reason why Pesach, how do we start with Bibhilu Yatsan? What did Bibhilu? They went in a panicky way. When Pharaoh got up and he says, Kumutseo mitoch ami, get out, get out. The Jews didn't have the time to prepare bread with which to take to the wilderness. They couldn't wait for the dough to rise. Remember all the laws of Chametz? Because they couldn't wait. They had to take whatever they prepared quickly, and it was in a stage of matzah before they rise, before it rises. And why is that? What's the big deal? I mean, they were there 210 years, so they couldn't stay a few more minutes. Our sages said, if they waited one more minute, they would have reached the 50th level of tum'ah, of impurity, and they would never be able to get out. That's the reason why they had to get out. So that's, by the way, the whole philosophy about chametz in Pesach. That's the secret. Yes, if they had they stayed one more minute, they would have entered the 50th level, and they would have never got out from Egypt. Okay. In comparison with the 50 levels of tum'ah, of impurity, there is also what we call in Kabbalah, 50 levels of purity. In order to bring the Jewish people out from Egypt at that kind of situation, it had to be a miracle. So therefore God had to perform miracles, which we all know, and that's how they came out. But you might say, how long will it take for a person who has been so low, so many years? It'll take many years for him to recover. You know, impurity is a sickness. To recover from a sickness depends on how long was the sickness. If the sickness took 1 year, so the recovery will take 1 month, 2 months. If the sickness was for 200 years, then the recovery will take at least 20 years. So the Jewish people left with the sickness of the 49th level of impurity. That's a spiritual sickness. Tum'ah is a sickness known in the literature of our sages. For them to recover would have taken who knows? And you send them into the wilderness. When you send them into the wilderness, what do you expect from them? At least send them to yeshivot, send them to... But there was no yeshivot at that time. There was no Torah yet. And you send them into the... But they were all, they came from the seed of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. But yet, I mean, they were spoiled for 210 years. They were completely disrupted from their original integrity that was given to them from the seed and the blood of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. During the slavery time, it was all wretched. But now they went out. How long did it take for them to reach the mountain of Sinai? You know?
40 days.
49 days. Yeah. That's the time. Right. Shavuot, when they came out from Egypt, it took 49, that's the 49 days that we count between Pesach and Shavuot. Right? That's why we count the Omer, you know. Reuben, true or not?
Yeah.
49 days. In 49 days, such a short time, they were brought to the mountain of Sinai. Do you think to be brought to the mountain of Sinai, to see God giving the Torah and to receive the Torah, you would be able to do that in such a state of low impurity? They came out the worst kind. This was the lowest kind of level. And yet, when they were brought to the mountain of Sinai, God made sure that they are going to receive the Torah. To receive the Torah, at the mountain of Sinai, you have to reach, to climb back into at least the 49th level of purity. In fact, the sages of Kabbalah say And here I am going to share with you something. I don't know if you will appreciate it. But the sages of Kabbalah say that the last generation is fighting with the fifth level, with the 50th level. Shomat, Marina?
No.
The last generation, we are fighting not 49. We have reached the 49th level already, this generation. Now we are succumbing. That's the reason why this generation is the generation of the Mashiach. Because God forbid, if it will wait any longer with what's going on in the world, we will reach the 50th level, and the 50th level will be gone, finished. But not, the only problem is that once the Jewish people is gone, the whole world is gone. You don't believe that? Well, I don't want you to see it. But that's the truth. The world was created for Am Israel. There's no Am Israel, there's no world. Maybe we are just fantasizing. But believe me, even the Goyim know that. Even the Arabs know that. They know. All they want, why is it that they are fighting us? It's because they are fighting an idea. Maybe we are not that people that originated from the Bible and from God. Maybe we are a different type of people. That's why they are trying all the time to say, nah, I heard last week a certain program in which they said that, you know, the bounding of Yitzchak, that Abraham went to, it's not Yitzchak, it's Ishmael. No, they can say anything they want. And yet they were able to have billions of people believing in this stuff. Unbelievable. But each one of them knows the truth. They know us. Otherwise they wouldn't be bothered so much by us. You know, it's an obsession. Look how much they are suffering, and they are willing to take the suffering as long as remove that people from us already. But why? You could live with us and enjoy yourself to have a decent life. No. The idea of having the Jewish people still alive, that's just too much. That means the theory is not working. That means their theory is not working. They counted on Hitler to finish and to solve the problems. Didn't work. And that's the problem. So now we are dealing with this generation. We are already past the 49th level of immorality. I'm sorry to tell you, but that's the truth. I have seen it and I see it every day, that we have reached that level. There's no generation before in the world, even the time of Sodom and Gomorrah, did not reach the immorality of today. That's the reason why it's going to be this generation to bring the Mashiach. Because if you wait any longer, there will be nobody else to redeem. As soon as the Mashiach comes, we are going to jump higher. The Jewish people is going to jump higher, no end. You don't believe this? All you have to see for now is see what's happening around you. What's going on today? You know that today we already see it by the thousands, if not by the hundreds of thousands. And already hundreds of thousands have become religious. But let's say many of them came little by little. But you know that many people from a state of anti-Jewish, they became super Orthodox overnight. I had a neighbor like this. A neighbor. He was in Shchonat HaTikva. She even showed us how she used to dance belly dancing. Yes. Now she is 10 times more religious than me and you. And you should see her husband with a beard going to his knees. And meaning it. That's the point. She gave her life for it, almost. And her belief in Hashem, that is extraordinary, made her win a battle against cancer. That everyone was sure that he's going to, now Baruch Hashem, she's okay. Not only this, I know many, many people like this, overnight. So now you see that there is such a possibility. So it's not anymore like if you were for such a long time non-religious. You know, some people, when they are not religious, you tell them you're going to be religious, they will laugh at you. Me religious? Never! The same people, overnight, they became religious. Suddenly something happened, they became religious. And today we see this by leaps and bounds, in quantities that are unbelievable. And this is only an introduction to what's coming. Because when Mashiach comes, first, before the Mashiach, you should know 3 days before. I don't know what is the meaning of those 3 days. But 3 days before, Eliyahu HaNavi will come. And then he will come. Reuven, you do tefillin every day, that is true. But try now a little more. Then he will go to somebody else. You don't do anything. Come here, put tefillin. And suddenly, think there will be such an aura, an automatic aura. It is possible that it will come in a very nice way. But because we are the nation that is known as the stiff-necked people, Am Keshe Oref, that's why probably it's going to be tough. And then after that, at the end of the regime of Ishmael, when Ishmael is gone, then the Jewish people will raise its head. Once we raise our heads, overnight, you will see people who were never, who hated the Torah. They will become so thirsty, they will come and beg anyone who knows anything, please teach me, teach me. But not only Jews, even Goyim, they will come to you. Marina, please help me to put my talit, I don't know how to put it. You know how to? so you might think that I'm talking as some fantasy here going on. Why fantasy? Before they discovered the moon, they thought it's a fantasy. Now they don't even talk about it. Jews in Russia, they thought it's a fantasy to see them out. They came out, Baruch Hashem. Jews from Russia will become religious. Today at least 25% is religious. And the rest of the Jewish people is coming around. The work is still very, very, very long. I'm not saying that it's over. It's not over. But apparently, circumstances in the world are helping. Little by little, America will be against us. Britannia, Europe will be against us. And in the world, we will be completely alone. The state of Israel will be totally... And then Jews will have to face the reality. Whom are we going to trust? Perhaps many of them will raise their eyes to the Lord. That's all it takes. And now you are ready to accept the Torah again at the mountain of Sinai, in a figurative way, to talking figuratively. The Torah is here. The only thing is that we have to see how the people are ready for it again. We might think that this can never happen. It will happen overnight. Overnight. Like I said, Islam, today, very powerful. If I tell you that overnight it will disappear, don't believe me. You probably are going to see it in your lifetime. Christianity, same thing. We are going to discover that this is the Barim Betelim, Shtuyot, everything. And, you know, in Japan, there is already a movement that is interested in Bible and things, and they are committing themselves to such, to dangerously, by the way, to approaching Judaism. And it starts. It seems to be low. It seems to be slow. But it will take off. When the time comes, it will take off like fire. And this is something that we can pray that it will happen in our time. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that things will be easy. As I said last week, there is in the Talmud a certain statement by one of the greatest Talmudic sages by the name Ula, who said, Yete vela achmine. In the time when he comes, when the Mashiach comes, let him come, but I don't want to see him. Of course, he didn't mean that he doesn't want the Mashiach. He meant that it's going to be so painful. He probably meant before the Holocaust. So, of course, looking at the Holocaust, we have lost so many Jews in such a terrible way. It is true. We believe that Chafetz Chaim said, It's possible from the work of Chafetz Chaim that we understand that the Holocaust is already the majority of that which we call Gog u'Magog, which is going to battle against Ishmael. Maybe next time when we come, I will bring you the list of predictions that we will tell you what's going to be in accordance with our sages. And we shall tell you exactly what is going to happen in accordance with our understanding, because we cannot trust our understanding to be 100% sure of what it says. But the codes of the Bible, the predictions of the Zohar, the statements of the Talmud, and the biblical prophecies are all together working together today, and they bring us a picture that is becoming clearer and clearer. Yes, my friends, it's coming. The only problem is, let me cite, I will conclude with the following statement made by Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai said, in Zohar, Parashat Shemot, chapter 7. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, כשראה את דורנו ברוח קודשו, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai lived 2,000 years ago, and he saw our generation with his eyes, with his vision. And he said, when he saw our generation, beginning from the 19th century up to now, that's our generation, including the Holocaust probably, Zakaf Yadoi Ubacha, he raised his fingers, his hands, and cried. And he said in Aramaic, Vai man deizdeman behauzimna, woe to the one who will be at that time. That's our time. So first he said, woe to the one who will be in this time. And then he says, how lucky is the one who will be in this time. Take it any way you want. But it shows one thing, that this time might be difficult, and yet it's worth it to live it. And we live in this generation as the luckiest guys in all the centuries, because we have seen extraordinary things, and what is yet to be seen is just unfathomable, unbelievable. And that's what's waiting. Hopefully, there are two ways how the Mashiach will come. If Am Israel will come back to its senses before, without the intervention of Eliyahu HaNavi and the Mashiach himself, then things will come the easy way, with peace, prosperity. The world will discover suddenly the necessity of having Israel in the world. The world will need Israel. The world will proclaim Israel as the state of God. And the Jewish population in Eretz Israel, without exception, not even one Jew that does not perform the mitzvot will be tolerated. Impossible. But not the way of the Islam, Chas v'Shalom. There is no such a thing in Judaism. In Judaism, the Torah tells us it has to be in your hands. It has to be your free will. No one can come. It's not like Islam when you don't. Why do you think you have over 1.5 billion people Islamic? Why? 99%, if not more, than all the people who took Islam is only because of the force and the fear to leave it. You know, many of us, we are afraid to say anything against Islam. Anybody who says something against Islam, if he is an Arab, he will be killed. That's the reason, that's how they keep their religion amongst so many people. But that shows also that this religion will be completely eradicated in one night. When the occasion will present itself, all of them will drop the religion. Because it doesn't make sense. It just doesn't make sense. Like our predictions say, Ishmael, you cannot expect justice. You cannot expect honesty, you cannot expect integrity, you cannot expect pity or compassion. Everything is just wild, wild, wild. That's Ishmael. So this religion doesn't make any sense. How come half the world is them? Fear. Once this fear will be completely neutralized, Islam will cease to exist. So the world will see in Am Israel, the nation of God. But for that, we also have to check our own records. And we have to do the best. So again, coming back to the question with which we began the lecture, what is expected from us today? Is it really purity? You do the best you can, but nobody expects you to be the best. You do what you can. So if you fail, don't give up. Keep on trying. Because by keeping on trying, you are telling a message to God. God, we are not against you. In fact, we love you. Unfortunately, we are weak. And we try. But understand, please, that this is not a rebellion. We want you. And help us, if possible, to find you. But at the same time, we are practically creating our link with him and the preparation of our neshama when it goes back to its place. And that's the destiny of the Jewish people. The destiny of the Jewish people is to bring to the world an image of perfection compared to the others and consolidation of the spirit and, of course, the ultimate religion of all times. It's difficult to believe, I know. But if you look around what's happening today, you will find that it's not anymore that difficult to believe. My friends, I bid you farewell. For next two sessions, we will not be here because I'll be in Israel. Let me dedicate this lecture to my daughter, Tehila Hillel, my daughter who is about to give birth any second. And I wish her to have Leda Kalla B'Sha'a Tova Mutzlachat, Amen. And with your help and your prayers, Be'ezrat Hashem, that everything should be well. Let it be B'Mazal Tov, Amen. And to anyone who also is in that verge, let him also have the best he can.